So, morning. I hope everybody is still healthy and eager to learn more things. Please let me know if you're able to hear me properly and chat. Once we will have confirmation, we'll need to. See me and hear me properly. Okay, so I have a confirmation that you are able to hear and see properly. That one is saying that. Mike is how about now? Are you able to hear me properly now? We will wait a couple of seconds and let's see. 1, 2, 3, test 1, 2, 3. Okay, thank you, Horatio. Okay, Bogdan, thank you for the confirmation. Okay, so today we will discuss about system services and sensors. So those are some, if you like, services that are available only on mobile applications and mainly the sensors part. As we know from other type of applications, on web and also on desktop, at some point we need to process things in background, okay? And this is true for mobile as well, and we will see some differences here for the first time between the capabilities of the main platforms, what's available on iOS versus what's available on Android, and also on the multi-platform frameworks. But the idea is that at some point we will need to perform some processing, either logs or if we are maintaining level information in a game, let's say, or if we are taking pictures to be able to process and scale properly those images. And like we already discussed at laboratories, even for CRUD operations, we need to perform some sync operations, okay? So to be able to retrieve data from the server side when, let's say, our mobile device is offline for some time, when we are reconnecting to the internet and also we establish a connection to the server, at some point we need to perform a synchronization. And this is true, we will discuss at laboratories. This is true for the last laboratory that we will have. We will need to ensure that once the application is gaining access back to the internet, we need to present the latest data for the user or to ensure that the application is pushing to the server the data that was collected while offline. And we can have all sorts of processing data background tasks. So tasks that are not necessarily involving the user. So they may be started by the user on the front-end side, but once it's started, that task will run on its own on the background side. And we have a couple of options here. So we can use, as we saw in previous demos, we can use Java threads together with the infrastructure that the Java is providing, like executors and the whole API that's available there. We have services, we have async tasks, we have specific for Android handlers and loopers. Those are similar to threads that are designed to be used on the interacting with the UI. As we saw in the previous lecture, we can use coroutines to execute tasks on the background and on a execution thread that's different than the UI thread. And we discussed there why it is important not to perform DB or network operations on the UI thread. Starting with API 21, the Android framework team noticed that this is a pattern that's used frequently. So the need for running something on the background is something that happens in almost all the applications. And because of this, they started to provide us access with the infrastructure to execute jobs. So if we are running on API 21 plus, we are able to take advantage of that framework. Also, there are services that are available in the system, like the network manager, the communication Google communication manager, that's allowing us to connect and retrieve information from the Google Cloud. So there we can execute tasks. And when we are dealing with retrieving and handling data at the operating system level, we have sync adapters that are able to convert data from one provider to another, loaders that know how to retrieve data, and even older, for APIs older than 21, we had an alarm manager that can be used to schedule a certain task at a certain point in time. From Jetpack Compose, starting with Jetpack Compose, they noticed that the developers were still having trouble with the fragmentation of the options that are available, and they tried to unify them under a work manager. And we will discuss about it in a couple of seconds. But before that, we need to discuss why it's important to obey the user settings and also the system settings. So the battery optimizations, as you probably saw, from one version to another are more aggressive. And this is to ensure that the users are able to use their devices throughout the day, at least. And in Marshmallow, they added a service named Doze Mode and application standby that will detect when the user is not interacting with the application or with their device, and will lower the CPU clock, will turn off the background threads. And this is important for us when we are trying to schedule some deferred task or background task. We need to be aware that in Doze mode or application standby, things will not run as we are requesting them. So even if we are saying, let's say, that we would like to execute a task once per minute, let's say, or at 12 o'clock exactly, that will not be a guarantee, because the operating system will try to always to improve the user experience and to save battery. And it may delay our task. And you'll see that from version to version, we are facing, regarding the background execution, with more challenges. So if in Marshmallow we started to experience Doze and standby, the next version, we started to see that our broadcast receivers are limited. So because of the same thing. Also in the next release, they restricted the API regarding the wake logs and added more limitations for the background services. And I think the latest ones were added in Pi regarding the options on how we can schedule the tasks. And also here they specified buckets for the apps, so you can specify for notifications and also priorities for the apps on when they are running, and based on that the operating system will associate your app with a priority bucket. And also starting with this version, they restricted the background operations, some background operations like pushing information on the screen while the code is running in a background service, also acquiring sensor information, some type of sensor information like location, because they noticed that some applications were abusing the background threads and the capabilities of the services. Like certain popular apps were displaying ads on background, so the user was not able to see them even, but they were displaying the ads and gaining revenue based on the usage of their apps. And because of that and others, they started to add restrictions. As we saw in the first lecture, right now we have or the users that are using Android at least are not on the latest version, not even close to the latest version, as we can see here with Android 10. And I did a check yesterday. Android 10 has only 8% of the devices brought up to date. The next big chunk is still of the user is still on Pi and Oreo, and we still have other older APIs that are available. As we discussed back then, we know that Google is trying to move all the applications at least to Android 10 by forcing us from the 2nd of November this month to target API 29. So we are able to support even older devices, but the target should be API 29. And this is a move to try to increase the user base and to move the applications to the latest APIs. Why is important in this topic for us with background threads, the compatibility chart? It's important because in older APIs, we don't have access to certain things. And if we are discussing them here by the following four metrics, so when we are trying to schedule something, sometimes we need an exact timing. So we would like to be able to execute as close as possible to 10 o'clock, let's say. A task. So if you like, let's say if we have morning routines, we would like to execute them at 8 in the morning or 7 in the morning, depending on the user's preferences. And it doesn't make sense to delay those more than that, to display them in the evening, because they don't add any value. Also, there are other features that we would like. Let's say if the API is able to execute them with a guarantee to get a feedback if the task was executed or not, or if it's trying to execute it at the specified time, so to perform the best efforts to execute it exactly or close to that, or if we are able to execute it in background, so to defer the work and get notified after that if needed or not. And based on what we studied until now, we know that threads are trying, we can, even with coroutines, we can establish exact timing and best effort, let's say. And the same is true for deferable and best effort. So with threads and coroutine, we can say that the system will try to execute it. It's not guaranteeing that the tasks will be executed, so it's a best effort. And we have the capabilities to defer them, to execute them in background, or to execute them with the run blocking for coroutines, or with threads, we can block and join the execution. So we can do a deferable or running on let's say the foreground. So we can implement both exact timing and deferable. For the exact timing and guaranteed execution, here we can use also coroutines, because as we know with structured coroutines, we can get a feedback on what's happening. But also we have the foreground services that are part of the API 21 and plus. So those are available for us. Like I said, for 21 API and plus, we have the new API named Job Scheduler. And here we will present the options that are available also for older API. So if we don't have API 21 and up, then we have something that's similar to Job Scheduler named Job Dispatcher that was available, but that's available only to devices that are on API 18 and plus. And for the devices that are not having even the Job Dispatcher, we may use the Alarm Manager or Broadcast Receivers that were available even on devices that are not supporting the Play services, the Google Play services. Okay, so we can use those to schedule on background jobs that will guarantee the execution. So we will get a notification if the execution was done successfully or not. Like I mentioned before, the Jetpack team noticed that there are issues on handling and supporting multiple devices on different API levels, and they came with a new API named Work Manager that is trying to replace all of them. And behind the scenes, they will use the Job Dispatcher if you are on an API lower than 21, or even alarms and broadcast services if you are on something even older than 18. Okay, so we have the capabilities to be able to run in all sorts of configuration our tasks. Like I mentioned, a big chunk of the tasks will be executed with services. And the services, if you like, are threads, or similar to threads, are applications, activities that are running on background. So they are not, usually they are not interacting with the user. They will be triggered by the user and they will run in background. And their purpose usually is to handle long running operations. And we will not provide feedback to the user more than the task completed or failed. And even if we are leaving, let's say, our application, that task will survive and will run in background. And here we have some samples like transactions. So whenever we are initiating a network transaction, that's happening usually on a background task. And we will be notified, as we saw with coroutines, only with the result. And that operation is asynchronous. when we are playing some music, let's say, we would like to be able to switch to another app and the music, the play to still happen. So for these purposes, we have services that are dedicated to handle that scenario. Whenever we are serving files or media to other applications, all of those are happening on the background. So the content provider that we saw in the second lecture, I think, behind the scenes is implemented using a service. It's hidden for us, but it's implemented with a background service. And what's important here is what we highlighted on the slides, that the user is able to switch to another app and our task will survive. So until now, everything that we created in an activity or a framework, if we were switching off the application, that task was canceled. Okay? And this is the beauty of, let's say, coroutines, the structured coroutines, that they are hiding behind the scenes the cleanup. So they are ensuring that if the user is switching off the activity or the application, those coroutines will be canceled automatically. And this is a benefit or a disadvantage depending on how we are seeing the job. But in most of the cases, it's a benefit for our user because prior to them, if let's say a user was starting a background processing image activity with a normal thread, if the user was, let's say, switching from that activity to another one, maybe they didn't notice that we are processing something or they didn't care. That background task was consuming CPU and battery, and maybe even produce memory leaks or at least consuming power, and the user didn't care about those results. With coroutines, we can prevent that. Also, the coroutines API, like we saw, is allowing us to be able to perform the background tasks if needed and still capture the results. But with services, they are dedicated to continue the run, even the user, let's say, exit the application. So are specialized to perform such tasks. And we have three types of services, the foreground one. So here the job usually needs attention from the user. It's something that's running on background, like we said, when we are playing a melody, the user may interact. It can skip forward or backwards or to the next track. So it's something that the user will interact with, but it's still playing and running on a background thread because the main focus for the user will be in another application. Okay? So those type of services are running on foreground. So are services that are running on foreground. We have background services, so services that will be started at some point by the user or the application, and from that point on, the user will not see anything, like processing images before uploading them. And even the upload, let's say, task is something that the user doesn't care of. So it's something that will be handled by the operating system on behalf of our users. And here we can use to schedule them to be able to be executed in a batch mode, let's say, instead of pushing each time each image, let's say, to upload it, we can batch them and execute them together. Those batching operations will have benefits in terms of connectivity, let's say, if we are on cellular or on a metered Wi-Fi, we can limit if those background tasks should be executed or not, and they are part of the API. The third type of services is named bound, because it's acting like a client-server service. So here the applications will be able to connect to the service and interact with it. Okay, so, and it's running as long as we have at least one client, at least one application connected to the service. Once the last application will unbind from the server, from the service, sorry, the service will be destroyed. So it's maintained alive as long as at least one client is bound to the service. And compared to the others, here we may have multiple clients that can interact with the same service. All the services are implementing the same contract. So we have an on-start callback that will allow us to configure the service. So here we will be able to define the initialization part and establish the behavior of the service. If we are providing binding, this is not mandatory. But for the foreground and background, we will need to perform the initialization step. OnBind is a callback that even if we don't like to implement a binding service, we need to implement it, but the implementation is pretty easy because we will return null in this case. And this is how the system will establish that we have a binding service or not. If we would like to have a binding service, then we will need to extend the binder interface, and also here in the onBind we will return an instance of the iBinder interface. And you can check more details on for all of them on the link below. OnCreate is something similar to the OnCreate of the activity, and it will have the responsibility to set up the service. So as we are saying here, it will be called before the onStart and onBind. So here we will create caches, let's say, or establish the connection with the server behind the scenes, and onStart and on the onBind, there we will only resume the connection. Okay, so onCreate will establish all the initializations that will need to survive, let's say, client connections on byte. On destroy, like the name is saying, here we will have the chance to perform the cleanups that were done on create. And when we are declaring and when we would like to create a service, we need to declare it in the manifest file, similar to what we do for activities, but here we have a dedicated tag named service, and we need at least to specify the class that is implementing the service. Okay, so service name, and then the class that is implementing the service. Optionally, we can add a description, and this the description from here will help the user. So in settings, there is a section where you can find all the services that are running on the device. And there, besides the name, you'll see a short description. That description is the one that we, as developers, are adding here. So please pay attention when adding descriptions here to convey the user the purpose of the service. To create a service, like I said, we need to implement certain callbacks. Usually we will extend the service class, like here, and based on the usage, we may have extend the handler with a looper. So if we would like to push information to the user, let's say, then we will need a looper. A looper is an object that will handle the asynchronous behavior of our service and will be able to store the messages for our UI to retrieve them. Okay, so it's acting like a buffer in our case. And here we can see how we are declaring our handler, service handler, and we are doing here only a sleep operation. So usually there we will implement some processing, let's say. And here as well, once we are done with the processing, the fake processing, let's say, we can see how we are turning off the service. So from the service itself, we can use the stop self call, and we will turn off the service. In onCreate here, we are initializing the service, and as we can see here, we are starting the service, and also we are ensuring that we have the looper associated with the handler. On start command here, we are only for demo purposes, we are sending a message, and we are using the start sticky flag here when we are returning. So it's an integer value that we can configure to specify that this service should be restarted if the application is killed, let's say, because it's not a binding service. As we said, we will return null. And on destroy, we are only performing a logging. So we are saying, notifying the user that the service was done. We don't need to do any cleanup in this demo service. So this is how we are initializing the service. From this point on, the operating system will run and manage the service. There is another type of class of services, like the intent services. Some of you already learned about intents, and we use them until now only to start another activity. So we created the intent to start another activity. Similarly to that, we can start a service. So we can have an intent to start a service. And usually this is the most common scenario. If we would like only to execute something in background, we can easily create an intent service. So we are extending the intent service behavior, and then on the on-handle intent call, there we are implementing our task. And here again, we are doing only a sleep operation. From code, so from our activity to start an intent service, we will do something similar to what we have here. So something similar to what we were doing also in activities to start another one. So here we are using the intent call, and after creating the intent using the also keyword, we can specify in a lambda to start the actual service. To stop the service, we have, like we saw, when we are running in the service, we have the stop self call that will stop the execution of the running service. Or from outside, if we have a reference to our service, we can call stop service. Okay. Here we are presenting some additional API that's usually used alongside with services, because from the services we need at some point to notify the user. And we can use the plain old Toast API, or I don't know, other dialogues, let's say constructs, with a looper to send notifications to the user. Most commonly we will use toasts for this. And like we already know, so some of you are already using them, we can specify a duration, a long or a short duration, on which the operating system will display the message on the screen. And there are, if you will check the Toast API, there are options also to interact from the Toast with the user to capture some response. Another way to send from a background service a notification to the user is to actually use the notification API. And here you can see how when we are starting a service, we can in that service use an intent, a pending intent, to send a notification. And to construct the notification, we are using the notification builder. And here we can configure the title that the user will see, the text that will appear on the notification, if we have an icon, what's the content when the notification will be displayed. And here, by performing a click on the intent, we will move the interaction, the focus, to the example activity. So we are using that pending intent to send the user to a certain activity. Okay? And the ticker is the text that will be shown while the notification is collapsed. So one liner that will present shortly the notification message. And here in the, once we have the notification built, we can use the start foreground to start the notification and to present it to the user. Like activities, the services have their own life cycle, and here we are presenting what are the callbacks that are available for us. We already saw the onCreate and onStart command. The onBind will configure the behavior if it's a bindable service or not. onUnbind is the opposite of the onBind. So whenever a client will disconnect, there we will have the chance to react. And onRebind, whenever the client will reconnect, we will have the chance to re-establish or to set up properly again the connection. On destroy is the final callback. Whenever, so in a binding situation, whenever all the clients are detached, then we will get on destroy, or on a non-binding service, when the task is done, we will have the chance to properly clean up. Okay, so this is the comparison between a binding service and non-binding service. So only the way on how we are cleaning up and re-establishing the connections are different. Other than that, they are pretty similar. And we have a demo here. So in the repository, we have on the Git repository, we have a project named Android Messaging Service. And here, if we are starting the application, we will have an interface built like this. So it's a demo app that is allowing us to create some fake background tasks using the Job Scheduler API. Okay, so here we can establish a duration in seconds. So we may use 5, let's say, and we can configure some restrictions, like the task should run only if we have Wi-Fi connection available, or if we don't care about having a connection or the type of the connection, we can choose any from here. We can start the job with a delay, so we can say to start it after, I don't know, 10 seconds, to launch the execution after 10 seconds, and we can specify a timeout as well. So if the task is not done in that number of seconds, or minutes, or hours, depending on the setting, the operating system will cancel the task. Also, we can specify if we would like the device to be plugged in. So maybe you noticed in Google Photos settings, you can configure when the pictures should be pushed to the service, to the Google Photos service, the cloud. So there you have the chance to check if those operations should be done only when connected to the power. And this is easily done because the job scheduler API is exposing that, and you can configure that a certain job should be executed only if the device is plugged in. Another setting that we can control is to force the execution only when the device is in the idle mode, so when the user is not interacting with it. If we have certain tasks that are not important when they are executed, we can delay them to be executed while the device is in an idle mode, so not to interrupt or to consume the bandwidth while the user is trying to perform some other interactions. So here we have some feedback. So in the on start, we are presenting by changing the color when we started the task. So because we didn't add any delay, it's starting as soon as possible. And when it's done, it's highlighting the on-stop task. So after 5 seconds, we should see the on-stop. We have some functionality here to cancel the task, let's say. So it started and we would like to finish it, so we can cancel the last task. Or if we are starting multiple tasks, we can cancel all of them by using this cancel logic. And if we are checking how all of that was implemented, so in our onCreate we are setting only the UI, and that's not too complex. We already know how to create UIs interactions. On stop, here we are destroying the service and we are using the intent to stop the service. On start, we are starting the service and we are sending also the messenger here. So that handler that will have maintained the link between our UI and the service. And when the user is pressing the schedule button, here is the logic that is performed. So we are using the job info builder. We are associating and we are adding our own identifier for the job, the one that is displayed here. So whenever we are starting something or stopping something, we are displaying a message with the job identifier. And this is the actual job here. But before starting the job, we are checking to see what are the settings that the user configured here. And you may see here how we are adding the latency settings, the deadline one, the flag if we would like to have a Wi-Fi connection, so something that's not metered, or we don't care about the network connection. And also here we are specifying the number. So this is something that it's a custom argument that we are sending to the job. So here right now we are configuring the number of seconds that the tasks should sleep. But theoretically, here we will send, and as you can see, we are using a bundle, and this type of bundle is special because it can be persisted. We can send any type of arguments here, okay? So once we have all of them configured, we will run the task, and here we are specifying the last two flags if we would like to run it while the device is idle or when it's charging, and we can combine them so both of them can be checked and they will be obeyed. Once we have everything set up and we specify the builder the configuration when how to execute the job, we will schedule the job using the job scheduler service. Okay, so we are scheduling the job. When we are canceling, we are using the same scheduler service, and we have a cancel all call that will cancel all of them. Or if we would like to finish the last one, here you can see how from the job scheduler we have a method named all pending jobs, so jobs that are running or waiting to be executed. And if we have some, we will select the first one, and by ID we can cancel a certain job. Okay, and we are showing some messages, as you saw here in the toast, when they are canceled or when they are finished, we are presenting a notification. Okay, so it's really important to notify the user whenever something is happening, even from background threads. Okay, from background services, we need to display some kind of a notification. If everything was done successful or unsuccessful, then we will present the error message. Okay, so please pay attention, because this will be a requirement in the exam. So we will need to ensure that we are properly logging the errors and also displaying some meaningful messages to the user. Okay, so like we said, for older devices, we are not having access to the job scheduler service. And for those, we need to use something that's available prior to those APIs. And like I said, we have the alarm manager available even on devices that are not certified by Google. They don't have the Play services. And an alarm manager is supporting those currently those four type of alarms. And they are related to how the clock is observed. So we have real-time clocks, and here we have variations. So we have access to two type of clocks, a real-time one and an elapsed real-time. The elapsed one is counting the number of seconds since the last boot. And the real-time clock is the clock that's available on the device. If our tasks don't care about a specific time, so only a duration, like execute that task, the specific task after, I don't know, 10 hours or 10 minutes, then we will use the real-time, elapsed real-time type of the alarm. If we would like to wake up the application, then we will use the variation with underscore wake up. If we would like to execute the task at a certain point in time, then we will use like executed at 10 a.m. We will use the real-time clock. Okay, and if we would like to wake up the application, then we will use the underscore wake up application. And the alarm manager can execute repetitive tasks if we are using the inexact repetitive call. So here we are specifying the alarm type, like the real-time wake up. And then we are specifying the delay. So the delay that the system will try to obey. In this case, we will wait a half an hour, and after that we will start the intent, okay? To cancel an alarm, we have the cancel API, and we are specifying the same intent to cancel it. We have a demo, but we will discuss the demo after the break. So we are taking a 10-minute break. Okay, so we are back. Like we said, we were discussing about how to schedule an alarm, and we will switch now to the demo. So please let me know if you are able to properly see the screen. So here we have another application named Repetitive Alarm, where we are using the alarm API to schedule an alarm. And we will start a one-time alarm here, and let's add the application in background. So what we are doing here, if we will take a look in our code, we are setting up a fragment, and we have this fragment here created, and we have some options in the menu like we saw. So we have an option to schedule a one-time alarm and to schedule a repetitive one. And we are using the type wake up. So theoretically, if after a minute the operating system will decide to run our alarm, we will see the app started back on the screen. So here we can see how we are creating the one-time alarm. So the type is one time in this case, and we are specifying the delay, or we can create a repetitive one with the same type in this case, so the real-time wake up. But this time we are specifying a repeating interval, so at 15 minutes intervals. With a delay of 15 minutes, we will do the same alarm. You'll notice that even if we added here 60 seconds, the alarm will sometimes not happen after a minute. So it may take a couple of minutes even. So we will leave that application in the background, and we will switch to the slides, and when we will come back, we will see if the alarm was scheduled or not. Like I said, it's not guaranteed to be scheduled when we are requesting it. At some point, it will be scheduled. On the latest operating systems, you'll see that they are more aggressive than they used to. And even in the API, they noted. So here, if we are checking the set alarm, you'll see that they are making some notes here. So starting with API 19, they are inexact. So even if we are saying that we would like to execute after 1 minute, that's not having any guarantee at all. So they are trying to preserve as much as possible the battery and the power of the device. To cancel an alarm, like we said, even on the slides, we can use the cancel call with the same pending intent. So we will get back to our slides, and if on the next demo, we will see if that application is in foreground or not. Okay? So you can try it on your device as well. Especially if you have something older, you'll see that eventually it will be displayed. The job scheduler is the API that's available newer than the one that we just saw. It's easily set up, so it's very similar to what we saw before. We have a service. We can specify as the service to have bind permissions as well, and we have a similar builder here. We already saw it on the demo with the builder API. We can specify latencies. We can specify deadlines. We can request a certain type of a network. And also, like we saw in the demo, we can specify when the task should be executed while charging or with idle. And like we saw in the demo, we are using the schedule call to actually schedule the build. And the actual task is the service component in this case. And usually we will not redo the demo here. Usually we are extending the job service. So if you will check the demo, you'll see the previous demo that we did prior to the alarm one. You'll see that we extended the job service there, and we implemented our logic in our OnStart. Like we said, in Jetpack Compose, they tried to unify all the APIs, so to make it transparent for us where we are running it. So behind the scenes, they will try to use the API that's available, but we as developers, we will be able to use the same interface. So we will use the work manager, and among the core classes, we have a worker that will define the actual job, the actual task for us. It will look something like this. So we will extend the worker class, and we will override the do work method. And here we will implement our task. It's important to know that we need to return here a type, because as we remember from the earlier slides, the work manager is a type of service that guarantees the execution. So we need to specify if the execution was done successfully or not. And as a failure, we have two type of responses: a retry, if we consider that maybe next time the task will succeed. So if our tasks implementation details are, let's say, dependent on certain conditions, or the server is returning a response like busy, let's say, we may retry the task. And by returning here the retry response, we are saying that the manager should reschedule at some point the task. Or if we know for sure that a failure happened, we will return the failure response, and that will signal the manager and the system to not retry or schedule the same task again. If the response is success, then means that everything was performed properly, and the user can react accordingly. Or if we are executing the worker in an orchestrated manner, in a chain flow, then the manager can move to the next task. Okay, it's important to note here that everything that's encapsulated and called from the do work is executed on a background thread. Okay, so here we don't interrupt the user interaction, because everything is executed by default on background. Okay, and we need to be aware, because if we are trying to send some messages to the UI, we need to use either, like we saw before, the notification API or a looper or something that will connect us to the UI. We are not able to use directly UI calls here, okay? Also, we have two type of worker requests, a one-time and a repetitive one, a periodic time worker request. And here we can see how we can enqueue, so how we can execute a defined task. So whenever we are willing to create a task, we will use the appropriate request, in this case the one-time work builder with our worker as the name of the template, and then the build operation will create us the actual task, and we will use the enqueue call from the work manager to register the work here. Okay, to be able to support all the capabilities from the job scheduler and also from the alarm, here we have a constraints builder where we can set things like the requirement for the device to be idle or charging. And once we build the constraint object, and you can check the API to see what are the other capabilities that are available, we will set the constraints to our builder when we are constructing the worker. Okay, and depending on the capabilities of the API, here some of them will be obeyed, some of them will not be obeyed. So the responsibility is done for us by the work manager, and it's hidden for us. So to cancel a task, we can cancel it by ID. So we have the cancel ID call, cancel work by ID call, and to get the ID of a certain worker, we have the get ID call. So please take a look on the documentation provided by the link below to check all the available constructs that are at our disposal. Like I mentioned, we can chain tasks, we can orchestrate them, and the work manager has some calls that are providing us easy ways to establish an order of an execution. So here, if we are imagining that we have three workers, A, B, and C, we can see how using the begin with, we can specify what will be the start of the task. And then once that one is successful, the manager will try to execute B. If B is successful, it will execute C. And we are enqueuing all of them using the begin with and then keywords. Like we mentioned here on the slides, each call is returning a work continuation object to be able to configure successive calls like that in cascade. We can do more than that. So each call has a number, a variable number of arguments. So we can specify that we would like to begin with worker A1, A2, and A3 in parallel. Once all of them are done, then we will execute B. So here behind the scenes, they are implementing a barrier. And once all those three are done, only then worker B will be executed. And once the B worker is done, C1 and C2 will be executed again in parallel. So using then and begin, we are establishing an order, a serial order, if you like. And by using multiple arguments for then and begin with, we are establishing a parallel execution. Okay, and using those two simple constructs, we will be able to create all sorts of complex scenarios, even one like presented here. So we are executing A and B in a chain, so the order matters for those tasks. A should be executed before B, and in parallel we don't care if they are overlapping or interleaving with A and B. Only the order between C and D is important, so C should be executed before D, and E, the E worker, should be executed only once the two previous chains are done. And here you can see how we are using the combine method to combine two chains. Okay, so we got two chains created with begin and then, and with combine, we are combining both of them, and then we are executing the E worker. Okay, So we created the third chain that is combining all of them. And we have a demo here as well. So if we are switching to our IDE, the demo is named Work Manager. So Android Work Manager, and this is an app from the samples that Google is providing. It's a little bit more complex. So let's execute the app. We have three modules here, so maybe this is something new for some of you that didn't saw this until now. So until now we had the app module. Now, at the same level with the app, we have a benchmark module that is performing some tests in this case, and we have a library, a common module that's used by the other two. And like we mentioned in the first lecture, they are all registered in the settings Gradle. So here we are including in the Gradle what are the other modules, and here we have modules, the main one, the project one, and then we have modules for, sorry, Gradle files for each module. So this is the common one where we listed all the dependencies. This one is the benchmark one where we have only the tests, and this one is the, sorry, this is the common one, the library one, and it's marked as a library module. And the first one, this one is the actual application module. Okay. And if we are checking the application module from here, we have an app that is only configuring some logging. And I think this is the main activity. So here, in the main activity, we have the option to select an image from the gallery or to use an image that's part of the application, a stock image. If we are selecting the stock image here, we will get a random image from the stock, and we have the options to apply some filters, and all of them are implemented. Even the saving part from here are implementing using workers. Okay, so we may choose what we should apply as filters. And then by pressing go here, we will launch the job. And once it's done, we have the option to see the output. Okay. Because we applied all of them, we kind of destroyed the image. So we can, let's say, apply only one, the grayscale. So let's apply that. And now the output will be a grayed scaled image. Okay. If we are configuring other workers, and you can configure it by adding your credentials here, you will be able to push the modified image to a third-party server, an imaging servers like the one highlighted here. But let's see what we are doing here. So we are checking if we have that client configured. If not, we will disable the logic from here, and then we are constructing the UI. And here, using the image operations object, we are consuming the settings that the user added. So you can see that we have fields for each of the filters from there, and also for the upload and save buttons. And if we are checking our image operations here, you'll see that we are converting only from those booleans to encapsulate them in flags. So we are capturing the values internally, and we have a build method that is constructing the actual flow of tasks. So, like I said, everything is returned as a continuation object. And here you can see how we are creating workers for each scenario. So, if the water color filter was applied, and we know that by this flag, we will create a one-time worker request where we are specifying some input data, and here is the call that is capturing the input data. So it's important to note that we can send even binary data like images. And once we constructed the worker, so the build method is constructing the worker, then we are registering it in our pipeline using the then keyword. Okay, and we have some logic here with has input to signal if for the next operations, if they are the first one, so they need to create the input data, or they are relying on the result from the previous tasks as an input data. So this is the has input data flag. So in the grayscale one, which is the second one, we are checking if we already have configured the input data, we will skip this step and only register the new task, because the input for this task will be the output from the water color filter. And we are doing the same thing for the blur. If we checked the save option from here, we are creating another worker that will perform the actual save. Okay, and here you can see that we are adding some input data, the original data, and also a tag to be able to detect the, so this will be the directory where we are saving the location. If we have the upload enabled here, we will create an upload task that will upload the image to the cloud. And if we are checking here, let's say the grayscale worker, like we said in our logic, so here we are extending a base filter worker because we have some common logic. Here in the base filter worker, we are implementing the coroutine worker, and we have the do work method. And what we are doing here, we are specifying only that we would like to have a foreground behavior by performing that call. We are setting up the context. So we are specifying what's the input because we are dealing with bitmap images. We are writing them, where we are writing them. And after that, we are delegating the work to the specialized class. Here we are applying the filter because it was a filter, and here we are doing only a grayscale filter. Okay, so something simple, and we are creating an image from the actual object that we created. And you can check all the others to see how we are performing similar things, but to add the blur effect, and how we are saving also the image. So if we are only, let's say, trying to perform certain things in certain orders, the manager will allow us to easily schedule the order and decouple the things related to the tasks from its work. So here in the filter, we are focused only on how we are implementing the filter. We don't care about other workers, what was their status, when they are running. We will only know that we receive an input data that we need to perform some computation on it, and we will return that bitmap as an output. Okay, so all of them are decoupled and are separate one from in each other. And if we are writing them in this way, we can be independent of the order in which they are started, and also focus on only what's important for the actual task. The work manager will allow us to focus on that. So please check this sample and try it on your own. Now we are switching a little bit the topic to discuss about sensors. So until now, what we did was only to interact with the UI part, and also now we saw how we can schedule tasks, but we didn't discuss about what in my opinion is a pretty big difference to what we studied until now: the capabilities that the operating the mobile devices are offering. They are packed with a lot of sensors. The sensors are peripherals that are able to provide us with input from the environment, from the context, on how the user is interacting with the app, with the device. And we have some categories here, like accelerometers, gravity sensor, gyroscopes, sensors that are providing us motion related area. So all of them from here are under a category named motion sensors. And depending on your API level and also on the device hardware capabilities, you will have one or more sensors in this category. Some of them are available on all devices, but some of them are available only on certain API levels and on certain devices, like the gyroscope one. In the last years, I think almost all devices are having a gyroscope. But if you are looking at the device from 2 or 3 years ago, the gyroscope was not available there. Okay, so we will need to pay attention on that. Another category is a category which is responsible with positional type sensors, like orientation or magnetometers, sensors that will be able to detect physical position changes of our device. Okay, and the last category are the environment type of sensors, like barometers, thermometers, and so on, that will provide us with some values from the environment, like available. We can use all of those combined to be able to, or individually, to be able to detect certain conditions. When to execute something, or when to notify the user that some conditions have changed and they need to react. We have a service named Sensor service that is allowing us to interact with the sensors that are available on the device. And using the Get System Service call, like we did for other services, here we will be able to grab a reference to the sensor service manager, and here we can see how, using the sensor list with a type, so sensor type is with sensor type, we can specify what sensors should the manager retrieve from us, from the device. So by using type all, we will get a list of all the sensors that are available on the specific device right now. And whenever we are trying to connect to an actual sensor, we will need to check if that sensor is available or not on that device. And we have a get default sensor call that we can specify a type, and we will get a response if that if there are sensors of that type or not on the device. And if they are, we can query and use with get sensor list of a certain type. Then we are getting a list of them, and we can see here in the slides how we can filter them to using the first or null. We will be able to filter, let's say, to get all the gravity sensors made by Google. So the vendor is Google, and they are on version 3, let's say. And if we have a sensor like this, so if the previous score returns something different than null, then we will be able to interact with the accelerometer, let's say. If not, we will provide an error for the user that the sensor is not available. We can register listeners, so we can create a listener that once we have a reference to a sensor, we should consume the values that the sensor is providing. So the sensors are acting like subjects. They will emit values, and depending on the service, they are emitting the values with a certain frequency. And here with the listener, we will have the chance to detect when the accuracy has changed. So there are sensors like GPS that will change accuracy based on what's available as satellites, let's say. Or there are sensors that in certain conditions are able to produce more accurate data, and we will get on accuracy change call, we will get a notification when that accuracy has changed up or down. Whenever the sensor is producing a value, we will get the callback on sensor changed. And here, from that sensor event, we will be able to get, based on the sensor capabilities, one or more values. A lot of sensors are producing three values, but we need to check the reference to see for each sensor what are the number of values and the meaning of each of those values. As a return, we are presented with a list of integers, and like I said, from the reference we can check and establish what's the meaning of that integer. For a light sensor, we know that the first value is representing the lux value, so the intensity of the light, and we can present that to the user or react upon it. Because we have a listener, we will need to pay attention on how we are managing the listener. So on resume, we are presenting the code on how we are registering the listener if the sensor is available. And on pause, we are unregistering the listener. If you remember from the first and second lecture, we specified that on pause and on resume should be used to initialize and on pause to unregister the listeners or to clean up heavy objects. In this case, the sensors, like GPS, let's say, are producing a lot of data. And if we are not properly unregistering them, we are consuming a lot of memory. So we are creating a memory leak. And depending on the sensor, we may consume also a lot of power and consume battery for the user. So please pay attention that we need to properly dispose them. Here we extracted only some information from the documentation. So from the motion section, we have the accelerometer, which has three values. The first one is the x-axis, the second one is y, and the last one is the z-axis. So based on using that accelerometer call, we will be able to get three values that will position us and determine the rotation and the force value for each of those axes. There are variations like uncalibrated values, which are cheaper to produce than the calibrated one, and we should use them accordingly. Other two ones that I think are important here to mention are the gravity and the gyroscope ones, and you'll see that we are producing, they are producing the same type of values, x, y, and z. So on each 3D axis, we are getting from the gravity a force, and from the gyroscope a rate of change on that axis. From the position category, we have a lot of them here, like the magnetic field. So some devices are able to detect magnetic field changes and are producing values, or orientation, to detect in degrees what's the orientation of the device. Or lastly, so in the last 3 years, we saw sensors that are detecting proximity and are able to specify us in centimeters or in inches, depending on the sensor type, what's the distance from the sensor to a given object. Okay, so those are pretty interesting. And we have, from the final section, from the environment one, we have sensors like the temperature one. Here it's producing only one value, so values of zero will contain the degrees in Celsius in this case, or depending on the sensor, you'll see sometimes if the phone was manufactured for US, you'll see that the output is in Fahrenheit, and so on. So please check on your device using the service manager what are the available sensors, and then for each sensor what are the capabilities, and using the reference you will be able to know what fields are producing the desired values. So here we have a demo, and if we are switching again to our IDE, we will see that we have an accelerometer play named project, and we will start this one. So even from the emulator we will be able to interact with sensors, because in the preferences here we have a section named virtual sensors, where we can interact with the app, with the device, the virtual device. So we can rotate it, and here you can see that we created a virtual table with some objects that are trying to interact with the physical environment. So we are rotating the device, and based on the rotation here we are simulating gravity. Okay, and you can see here the values and also what's happening, the logic that is implementing. So here you'll see that some of the objects will bounce, because we have some logic to implement some spring type of interaction there. So you can view and change that. So everything was done here in the play activity. On create we are setting up the display, and also we are, as you can see, we are using two type of services. The sensor one that we just presented on the slides, to be able to grab the accelerometer values. And also we are using the power service to be able to configure that we would like to keep the application on screen, and to prevent the idle mode. Okay, so here we are specifying that we would like to maintain the screen on with the power service. And on resume we are acquiring, and on pause we are releasing the locks, so to revert to the default behavior. We created a simulation view here for those objects, and this is a particular object, a particle. So that ball that we saw there is implemented here in the object. This is where we are resolving the conflict, so when two of those objects are touching, and how to react. And in the particle system, here we are creating the view, and we are updating the position of each of those objects in the update position call. This is the main update of the whole scene. And here is the logic where we are simulating that spring action. So when we are detecting a collision, we are here computing the distance between the two, and we are adding an effect, and then we are resolving again the collisions. What's interesting from the point of view of our sensors here is that whenever we are starting the simulation, we will register the listener. So this class will be the listener. And when we are stopping, we are unregistering the listeners. And because this class is the listener, we have the sensor changed callback here. And here you can see that we are interesting only on the events from the accelerometer type. So if we receive other events, we return from this callback. If we have accelerometer types, here you can see how we are extracting the X and Y axis from those, and we are detecting a certain rotation of the from the display. And based on the rotation, we will be interesting on those axes. We are capturing the values, and then on draw, we are using those values to draw all the objects on the screen. So please run the simulation on your device and try to implement a different physics here on what's happening, and build your own on sample using data from the accelerometer. We have another demo here named rotation, and let's see here. Let's run the application. We will use the same virtual sensors here. So here we have a cube. And based on rotating our phone, we will try to rotate the cube as well. And we added some animations as well here to make the rotations a little bit smoother. Okay, so you can try on your physical device as well, or in an emulator, and you'll see that we here did almost the same thing. We used the sensor manager here because we are rendering some cube information. We used specialized surface view, and we have some helper methods to implement the rotation of the matrix. But the idea is that to capture the or to react to the events from the device, we are using the rotation sensor. And here you can see how we are registering the listener for that. And here is how we are retrieving values from the rotation service. So the rotation service, like any other service, sensors are producing an array of values. And here we are using, from the sensor manager, we are using a helper method that is able to translate from an array the values into a matrix, because we have a matrix, a rotation matrix here, and we are applying the rotations using the matrix multiplication logic. So you can check those as well in the documentation. The idea is that if we are using specialized views, we gain access to all sorts of transformations and loading and multiplying logic to deal with certain objects like matrices, okay? 3D objects, pretty easy to implement. From our sensor point of view, we only had to implement the on change and to apply the call. Okay, so pretty simple to use. I think this is done with all the Android demos. We have some demos on iOS and on Flutter, and first we will see the Flutter ones. So under the same GitHub repository, we have a Flutter background fetch services project, sorry. And here, let me open the project. What we are doing here, we are demoing how we can execute something on background from Flutter as a task. And in a couple of seconds, while the app will run, we will be guided also how to interact with the background service. The idea is here we are using an object named background fetch. So because on iOS, like I mentioned in the beginning of the lecture, here we see an I think I'm running on the simulator here. Oh, let's stop this one because we didn't build for the simulator, and let's change to deploy on emulator. Maybe that will be quicker. So because on iOS we don't have so they didn't expose all the capabilities that the operating system is offering related to background services, we are restricted only to run background fetch type of services even from Flutter. In iOS, those are the only background services that are allowed. They are providing ways to interact with specialized media services, like playing a background song or a video, but are very limited compared to what the Android framework is providing us. So we are not able to chain or define workers. We are able only to use the background fetch API that we will see here as well. So here we define the call. In our main applications here, you can see how we are registering our task using the background fetch register headless task. Okay, and finally we will have the app running. And once that is registered, whenever we will receive some background notification, that task will be executed. So here we will retrieve from preferences a key, and we will update the current date basically with that key. And we have, hopefully it will install, we have some scripts to trigger on the simulator and also on the emulator that a background notification has arrived. So the workflow here is that we are defining something, a background service that will be executed whenever the system will trigger the interaction. So here finally it started. We received from our tests a lot of notifications. Let's clear all of them. And here we have some help messages to guide us how to trigger a simulation of the background. So for Androids, we have a script in our code here, scripts. And what we are doing here, if we will check, is we are using ADB and we are scheduling a job. Okay, so if we are doing simulate fetch from here, let's see both of them on the screen. So if we are running this one, we can see that our background fetch was triggered and we updated the current time. Because we are short on time, please check the other sample as well. Now we will briefly change here to execute a sample where we are consuming sensor data on iOS as well. So here we have an app that is interacting with the scene, and once it will start, we will see that we can interact. I think something happened with the simulator. Let's try a different one because we have multiple samples here. So this is the core motion one. I think is using the accelerometer from here and the gyroscope and the magnetometer that are available, and if it will load, we will see how we can interact with it. If not, maybe at the laboratories, because we don't have too much time now, we will see how we can interact with them. So if you have any questions, please bring them up in the laboratories, and we will continue the discussion in the laboratories. That's it for today. I hope that you enjoyed the lecture and you'll be able to use the background services and the sensors on your applications as well. We are ending up right now. Take care. Bye.